The peptide bond is an amide functional group that links adjacent amino acids. And in this webcast, we're going to learn that that linking group is a rigid planar entity and has some important consequences as to limit the degrees of freedom in a polypeptide chain. So here's a peptide linkage. It joins two adjacent amino acids. R and R prime would represent carbon alphas on adjacent amino acids, and so you should indicate that. The important point about this being an amide functional group means that there's an important N to pi star pi type interaction that is going to enforce significant amount of double bond character, about 33%, to the main linking bond in the peptide chain. That carbon-nitrogen bond that joins the carbonyl of one group and the amino group of an adjacent amino acid is going to have significant double bond character. And as a consequence of that, it's going to enforce rigidity in the peptide backbone, and it's also going to enforce planarity. In order for there to be maximum pi type overlap between the adjacent atoms there, they are going to adopt a planar geometry, and they're going to be side by side and parallel, so that all of these atoms are going to lie in one plane, and that's how we get that maximum pi type interaction. A consequence of that pi type interaction is that there's really two rotamer populations. So if we look at those alpha carbons, now they're represented as R1 and R2, and we think about this bond, that carbon-nitrogen bond, as having a significant amount of double bond character, we could imagine that there would be cis, which we call anti-periplanar for peptide linkages, or trans, which we call syn-periplanar. And the reason we call them anti-periplanar and syn-periplanar is because the dominant atoms, which take on top priorities, are oxygen and R2. And so you can see that in the anti-periplanar conformation, R2 and oxygen are on opposite sides of that carbon-nitrogen double bond, whereas in the syn-periplanar, oxygen and R2 are on the same side. But we also like to refer to this as trans when we think about the backbone. And so R1 and R2 are alpha carbons, and in the syn-periplanar conformation, you can notice that those atoms have a trans relationship to one another. So there's two significant rotamer populations. The equilibrium constant that governs that rotamer population is very much dependent upon the steric interaction between those adjacent alpha carbon atoms. And this table simply shows that as long as the R groups are anything of significant size, certainly an alpha carbon would be bigger than either an H or a methyl, that we're going to have a significant amount of the syn-periplanar or the trans backbone conformation. If we have an ethyl and a methyl group, we basically have a 6 kilocalorie mole difference favoring the syn-periplanar geometry, which for all practical purposes makes that 100%. A very, very tiny amount of the anti-periplanar conformation would be available. So that's the equilibrium situation, but there's also a dynamic situation. There is a barrier to rotation between the syn-periplanar and the anti-periplanar conformation, and that controls how fast one interconverts to the other. And 18 kilocalories per mole as an activation barrier means that at room temperature this is happening faster than one time per second. Each amide linkage, on the average, with an 18 kilocalorie per mole barrier is going to be able to be surmount that barrier on the order of about one time per second. If we look at a slightly extended version centering on the alpha carbon, and one of the things you might want to do is actually go ahead and make a model of this piece where the alpha carbon is right in the center. Here I have the cysteine group, and on either side I have an amino and a carbonyl group. Go ahead and draw that conformation, and remember that the two groups on either side, over here and over here, those are rigid planar groups. This is a representation of that. That rigid planar group on either side of the alpha carbon means that those bonds are going to essentially be locked in place, but we have two rotatable bonds, those bonds that join the alpha carbon. And those have torsion angles, that is how much of a twist there is, which is going to define how one plane, one amide plane, is going to sit relative to the adjacent amide plane. those two angles, psi and phi, can be plotted on what's known as a Ramachandran plot. And so each point on a Ramachandran plot represents an alpha carbon and the two torsion angles, phi and psi, on either side of that group. And what you can see is that there are very popular regions in this phi psi space, and for example, the alpha carbons tend to congregate into relatively small numbers of clusters. In fact, people have identified regions of what are known as allowed. The allowed regions are those regions that are colored in light gray. Those regions are beta antiperiplanar or antiplanar and parallel beta pleated sheets, parallel and antiparallel beta pleated sheets, alpha helix, that's the region down here, and then this is left-handed and this is right-handed alpha helices. And so you'll notice that the groups are populating secondary structures that are typical of protein chains. So each of these dots represents one residue in a polypeptide chain. This is happens to be a protein for the trypsin inhibitor, bovine pancreatic trypsin inhibitor. And so it's a protein of about 100 amino acids, and you can see that there are large clusters in the secondary structure regions with just a few amino acids that lie outside of those. And the amino acids that lie outside of those tend to be glycine. And glycine doesn't have a side chain, which allows much more degree of freedom so that those groups, so you can see here with cysteine as the side chain, there is a conformation in which the amide group or the carbonyl group is going to bump into that side chain. If that side chain is just hydrogen, as it is in glycine, there's quite a bit more flexibility.